Invitation.
Yeah, so we'll start the recording now. Yeah, sorry.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you very much for the introduction and the invitation. So, and yes, as I was saying, don't hesitate if you have any question during my talk. I prefer not to finish my talk, but have it everything clear. So, so today I would like to discuss actually why physics and novel nanotechnology is interesting for neuromorphic computing. As you know, artificial intelligence today consumes way too much power. If we wanted to simulate a brain, we would need a supercomputer that would dissipate the power of a small nuclear plant. And in contrast, the brain only consumes 20 watts. And so the goal of neuromorphic computing is to take inspiration of the brain organization to reduce the energy consumption of artificial intelligence, of neural networks. And the idea to do so is simply to reduce the data transfer between memory and computing that causes so much energy consumption in standard processors. And for this, the idea is to bring at the closest, like in the brain, synapses and neurons, because synapses can be seen as carrying the memory and neurons doing the processing. And so the idea for neuromorphic chips is to have this kind of architecture where we have, you see, layers of neurons interconnected by, so these are physical neurons interconnected by physical synapses that carry memory in situ and connect the neurons. And so if we do so, we can really gain orders of magnitude in energy compared to our standard processor when they run AI. So here, what you see in this very nice graph is on the vertical axis is the power efficiency of learning for electronic systems. And this is our standard electronic systems today, CPUs and GPUs. And these are neuromorphic chips. And what you see is that if we use standard electronics, we can already gain one order of magnitude. But if we use, in addition to CMOS technology, we complement CMOS with emerging nanotechnology, we can gain three orders of magnitude for the learning efficiency and energy consumption. And this is because these novel nanotechnologies, which can be diverse, have the ability to bring massive amounts of memory on chip and help emulate synapses and neurons. And so there is a lot of work in this area because these neuromorphic chips can solve environmental problems that are starting to be caused by artificial intelligence. They can speed up these algorithms and they can unlock embedded AI, which means small chips that could learn in mobile systems. So if we want to make neuromorphic chips, so we need to be able to, in a small chip, to have a huge amount of synapses and neurons. So if we want to make, for example, image recognition, benchmark tasks already require 100 millions of neurons and synapses. So we need a huge amount of these devices, and we need to connect them together, and we need them to perform the key operations of neural networks. So in neural network models are often illustrated in this way. The circles are the neurons, the arrows are the synapses. In software, most neural networks are very abstract versions of the brain, so everything is static. The information consists of real values, and the operations performed by neurons and synapses are arithmetic functions. So typically, a neuron, as illustrated here, is a function that is called an activation function, and it's the main requirement is that this function should be nonlinear. So one of the most used functions is a rectified linear unit that you see here of the input as a function of the output as a function of the input. As for the synapses, in the brain, synapses regulate the information between neurons, the strength of the communication. in algorithm, in most algorithms, they are weights for the neuron's output. So what a neuron receives is the weighted sum by the synaptic weights of the outputs of previous neurons. This operation that is written here is called a multiply and accumulate operation. And so you see that the synapse is a memory in the sense that the synaptic weight has to be memorized here, and it's tunable for learning. You have to be able to adjust the synaptic weight, and it can be positive or negative. Okay, and so today this architecture, when it's done on CPUs and GPUs, is completely lost. But the idea of neuromorphic chips is to really use physics to perform these operations, and to assemble these components in the densest way and with the lowest energy cost on chip. So one of the main solutions that is heavily explored today, and there has been a lot of progress in the last years, is based on hybrid CMOS memory stiff systems. So in that case, these are electronic circuits. So the information that circulates here are currents and voltages. Neurons are made of assemblies of transistors, so they have a size of about 10 micrometers. They take a current as input and have a voltage at the output, and so they are going to mimic this function, this kind of nonlinear function. Synapses are based on nano devices that are called memory stores. So the synapses are valves for the information. So memory stores are tiny resistors that can regulate the current that flows through a network. That can, these devices, they can be based on many different technologies. It can be filamentary oxide, it can be phase change memories, there are different possibilities, but most of them can be very small, scaled down to 10 nanometer. And when you plot their conductance as a function of the voltage between the electrodes of the device, there is this kind of response. What is important here is that you can see that by depending on the voltage that you apply, you can reach different conductance states. So this is a multi-level memory, so it can implement a synaptic weight. And you see that when the voltage is brought back to zero, these conductance states can be retained. So it's a memory, it's a multi-level memory. And you also see that if you apply large voltage, you are going to modify the conductance. So it means that you can train a network. But if you apply a low voltage, the conductance is not going to be modified, so you can operate the network without changing it. And what is really interesting with these devices is that there is a way to organize them on a chip that directly performs this multiply and accumulate operation that is key for a neural network. The idea is that you have neurons that output voltages. You connect the memory store in this kind of crossbar array organization architecture. And what you see is that if you do that, so here we have three memory stores with different conductances, you see that the current that flows out of this electrode due to the laws of the electricity is the weighted sum of the input voltages multiplied by the conductance. So you see that this conductance is a synaptic weight, and that the crossbar array directly performs the multiply and accumulate operation through the physics for free. So this is very efficient, very nice. One of the caveats of crossbar arrays is that if you want to make them very dense, they are going to be arrays of resistive devices. And so the current is not going to flow in a very controlled way in these arrays, so that can be sneak pass and so forth. And so it's estimated that the maximum size of this array would be about 100 by 100 neurons. So in the brain, there are up to 10,000 neurons connected to 10,000 others. So in order to make denser neural network and to make hierarchical neural network, you know, with different layers, you have to connect several of these crossbar arrays together. So this can be done in 2D as shown here, but also in 3D, so there are efforts to stack together these crossbar arrays, and this is a very beautiful result where you see that you can gain connectivity by putting these arrays together. So this is just an academic demonstration. We are not there yet at the chip level. What has been shown recently, 2 years ago by a team in IBM, is the first learning chip that co-integrates CMOS technology with this kind of memory stores. So in that case, phase change memory stores. So it's a beautiful achievement because this is a functional chip that actually does a neuromorphic task. So it's able to solve the MNIST task of handwritten digit recognition. So you give it this image and it can recognize the digit. So it really validates the interest of these devices for neuromorphic computing, but there is room for improvement. If you look at the success rate for recognizing these digits, it's quite low. It's a very easy task. So normally in software, you are almost at 100%, and here it's 92%. And this is due to two things. First, these are nano devices that by nature have some variability and noise and drift. And so to have high accuracy, this needs to be dealt with. And also, if you see the algorithm that is used here is a spiking restricted Boltzmann machine. Whereas today, neural networks, state-of-the-art neural networks, learn not through this kind of algorithm, but through the backpropagation of errors. And so to have a high accuracy means to change the algorithm of this chip. And so in this talk, I would like to discuss how we could use more physics, to use physics to tackle these two challenges, which remain to really build high accuracy, low power neuromorphic systems. The first one is the interconnection, and the second one is the learning. And so these are two disjoint topics that I will try to cover if I have time. And but we can discuss if there can be connections between these two in the following. Okay, so first, in my first part, I'm going to talk more about materials, and in the second part, more about algorithms. And here, in particular, what we are doing in my group, which is working on technology that is called the spintronics. So the motivation, as I said, is that in the brain, you have a very high, very dense interconnectivity. So every neuron in the cortex is connected to, in average, to 10,000, and in other regions of the brain, it's about 1,000 neurons. And to achieve this, the brain uses wires. So it's this 3D crazy ball of wires. Here, the different colors are the different neurons with the different axons connected together and dendrites. And you see that this is very difficult to achieve with current electronics that tends to be mostly 2D with straight wires. So there are different solutions using optics, for example, as some of you are studying. In my group, we are trying to see if we could not help the communication between neurons and synapses through radio frequency waves. Because after all, we know that radio waves can connect a huge number of mobile units like our cell phones. And so we thought it could be a nice way to avoid having too many wires in a neural network. But in order to do so efficiently, we also need to have miniature synapses and neurons that emit and receive these microwaves, right? And so this is what we believe spintronics can bring to neuromorphic computing. So the devices that we study are called magnetic tunnel junctions. So they are a sandwich of two magnetic layers with in between a very thin insulator. These devices can be scaled down to 10 nanometers, and they are today integrated into the production line of major foundries because they are the basic elements for magnetic memories. There are already prototypes of gigabits of magnetic memories based on these devices, which means that in practice, it's already possible to put billions on them on a chip on top of transistors that can route the signals between these devices. So when these devices are used as memories, what you are using is that the fact that the magnetizations in the two magnets can point parallel or anti-parallel. And this corresponds to a zero or a one. But here for neuromorphic computing, what we propose them is to use them in an other mode. So what's happening is that when you flow a charge current through these very small cylinders, originally the spins is random, but when you flow these electrons through the first magnetic layer, the spins carried by the current, by the electrons, get spin polarized. The electrons get spin polarized, and this polarization, these spins, can be transferred to the magnetization of the second layer in the form of a torque on the magnetization. And under specific condition, in that way, you can induce sustained precession of the magnetization. Basically, you bring it some spin and you can make it spin. And what is very interesting with these devices is that they are magneto-resistive. So when the magnetization changes, the voltage here across the device is going to change. And so these are experiments that I'm showing here. When we measure the voltage, we see directly these oscillations of the magnetization. And this is interesting because you see the time scale here, nanoseconds. This is a microwave voltage. The frequency of this voltage can be tuned by external means. So when we change the material, the alloy here, when we change the geometry, thickness, lateral dimensions, we can vary this frequency between 10 megahertz and dozens of gigahertz. Okay. And this is fixed. It's like a resonance frequency of this device. But then when we flow the current, you see that we are going to bring some spin to the system. And so the more spin we give, the faster the rotation, the larger the orbit of the magnetization, and we can also tune the frequency with the current. Okay. And because we can do that, it means that depending on the intensity of the current through the device, the amplitude of the voltage is going to vary. And so if I plot the emitted microwave power as a function of the input DC current, I get this nonlinear function, and you see that it's very similar to the rectified linear unit that I showed before. What it means is that this is a small, can mimic a kind of small microwave neuron. It takes an information encoded in the currents, applies a nonlinear function, and then emits the information, the new information, in the form of a microwave that it can broadcast if we want. So in these experiments, the lateral size of the device that we are using is quite large. It's 500 nanometers. This is why we need several milliamps. But if we scale down these devices to 10 nanometers, we can bring this power consumption down to microwatts, which is good for neuromorphic chips for tiny neurons. So this is the concept. And when we had this idea a few years ago, we said, well, we need to now to demonstrate that this is actually possible, that these devices can really emulate neurons, can perform neuromorphic tasks. And why we wanted to check that is because these are really very small devices, right? So they are, again, as I said, they are very variable, so they could show some noise, they could drift, and this could, a neuron, after all, in the brain is doing some kind of processing, so you need good enough stability to achieve some task. But we thought it was possible because these devices have been really so much optimized for memories that we, even at very small dimensions, we can make them quite stable. And so what we did, at the beginning, we only had very few devices, so we started with just one, one magnetic tunnel junction, and we wanted to do a neuromorphic task. And so, as you know, when you want to do some pattern recognition, you need a large number of neurons. And so what we did is that we have used frequency multiplexing to emulate a larger network. So it means that basically this, we use one magnetic tunnel junction to play the role of each neuron in a larger neural network, one after the other. So this is some sequential computing, but still the devices emulate the neuron. So we have used the framework of reservoir computing to solve a small spoken digit recognition task, where the goal is to recognize the digits between 0 and 9 pronounced by different speakers. And so, and here these junctions were only playing the role of the neurons, and all the rest, like the synapses, were done on the computer. And so what we have shown is that despite its very small size, through its rich dynamics and its stability, this very small device recognizes the spoken digits with a success rate of 99.6%, which is equivalent to larger hardware neurons or even software for the exact same task. So this was good because it validates the use of the device as neurons on chip. Then the next thing we wanted to show is that we could indeed have a microwave communication between these neurons. So in that case, we made a neural network where we use 4 of these devices, 4 magnetic tunnel junctions. So each junction is a neuron. And we built a kind of 2-layer neural network communicating through microwaves. So the first layer of neurons is emulated with 2 microwave sources. So this is lab equipment. And these microwave signals are broadcasted to the magnetic tunnel junctions in the second layer. And the signals that are encoded in the first neurons are vowels defined by 2 frequencies, FA and FB. So these signals are sent to a strip line. So it's a metallic line that is fabricated 300 nanometers above these magnetic nano devices. So when we send the signals, what happens is that they create a magnetic field, and this magnetic field is going to modify the magnetic, you know, the, all these devices have their magnetization that is doing some, having some orbit. So you can see if we plug a spectrum analyzer, you can see the microwave emissions of these devices. What happens is that when we have these microwave magnetic fields, they are going to modify the dynamics of the magnetization. And so actually, what we did is that we showed that they can even synchronize to the incoming signals. And depending on the synchronization patterns that we observed on the spectrum analyzer, we could recognize which vowel was presented at the input. So we could recognize the vowel with a good accuracy. So what this experiment showed is that we can have we can indeed have a neural network where communication between the different layers is due to microwaves. Now, what you see here is that we were sending the microwaves directly. We did not modulate them with synapses. So these are some kind of fixed synapse. And you know that for a accurate neural network, we need to have synapses. We need to be able to train the network by changing these parameters, which are the synaptic weights. So this is what we have achieved recently. We have proposed and demonstrated that we can make spintronic synapses that modulate microwave signals. And even more importantly, that we can perform this multiply and accumulate operation, so the weighted sum of the outputs of neurons with these devices. So this is published in this paper, the concept. So our idea is to use, in fact, again, the same device, magnetic tunnel junctions. But what we were doing before is that we send a DC current and we emit a microwave. And for the synapses, we are going to use them in a different mode where we send a microwave and we measure a DC voltage, a across the device. So what's happening is that you remember they have some kind of there is a ferromagnetic resonance. So there is a resonance frequency for the magnetization of the devices. So if you send a microwave current close to the resonance frequency of the devices, you are going to be able to generate large orbit precessions of the magnetization through resonance. And when this happens, the resistance is going to vary also. So we send a microwave current at a given frequency, and we generate oscillations of resistance at the same frequency. And the mixing of these two generates a DC voltage that we can measure across the device. And so this is an experiment. You see this DC voltage as a function of the frequency here of this incoming signal. And so the mixing gives this particular shape of the resonance. So a bit counterintuitively, the voltage is zero at the resonance and is larger.
Sorry, Julie, I think there is a question from the audience.
Sorry, I didn't see.
But we don't hear. Maybe you can put it in the chat, Roberta. The sound is not working well.
You cannot hear me?
Yes, now
I can hear you, yes.
Okay, I tried before because the question was actually a couple of slides before, sorry.
Okay, sorry, I didn't see your question.
It was when you I didn't understand before, previous please. Yeah, Tom, following one, oops. Where you were speaking about synchronization, this one. I didn't get what do you measure? So the plot that you are showing, what is it?
Okay, so what we measure, so here what's happening is that in the second layer of the neural network, yeah, I didn't really explain. I was trying to go faster. So the second layer of the neural network is composed, we have these four magnetic tunnel junctions that are connected in series. So we collect the signal and we send it to a spectrum analyzer. So if I had just these four and these four oscillators, we send different DC currents, so they have different frequencies. So if I don't have any input and I just measure the oscillators, I would get four microwave signals at four different frequencies. Mm-hmm. But what's happening is that we send microwave inputs and you can see them, they are in red. And what happens is that these microwave inputs, they can really modify the dynamics of the oscillators. And here you can see that instead of having four peaks as we have without inputs, here, the fourth peak as the fourth emission seems to have disappeared. But in fact, we know from a lot of other studies that it has been so much attracted to this microwave stimulation that it is synchronized here. And so in this particular case, we are in a configuration where this oscillator 4 is synchronized to input B. And this, for example, in our scheme could mean that we have recognized, you know, vowel A or E. Okay. It could be another sync pattern for another vowel.
So in general, you access a global quantity because it's like the current that is going through all the units.
Yes, exactly. We measure everything at the same time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So for the synapse, we use the same devices, but in another mode where they collect the microwave, and we use this DC signal as a function of the frequency. And so, at the resonance, the DC voltage is zero, and outside of the resonance, it's larger. And so what is interesting is that, of course, the more power you put, the larger the orbit, so the larger the DC voltage that we measure. And you see that the voltage that we measure really depends on the difference between the resonant frequency and the input frequency. If I'm here, for example, I have a positive DC voltage, and the more power I have, the larger the signal. If I'm here, I have a negative voltage, and the more power I put, the more negative the signal I collect. So this means that actually the DC voltage is proportional to the RF power And it's like it's multiplied by weight that depends on the difference between the resonance frequency of the device and the input RF power. Here it's a positive weight, here it's a negative weight. Okay, so this is how we make our synapses, basically. And what we show in this graph is that, so this is the curve of the voltage as a function of the power. And you see, in fact, by tuning the resonant frequency of the device, we can change the synaptic weight. We can change the slope of the power as a function of the voltage as a function of the input microwave power. Now, how we change the resonant frequency of our device is by changing the magnetic field that is applied to the device. So we do that in our experiments because it's good for our proof of concept, but in the future, so this is not very scalable and it consumes a lot of energy. So in the future, there are ways to modify the resonant frequency of magnetic channel junctions in a very power efficient way and localized way. Okay, but this gives the proof of concept of our synapse. And so how do we perform these our multiply and accumulate operation? The idea is to use frequency multiplexing. So you see that these kind of resonators, so they have this response. So it means that they respond in a given frequency band. And as I said earlier, depending on the material that we use and the size of the device, most importantly, we can go from 10 megahertz to dozens of gigahertz. So we have this huge frequency band on which we can sequentially put all these kind of filters, one after the other. And so if we do so, here you see we have chains of these junctions connected in series. These junctions, they produce DC voltages, so these voltages, they add up. So if we have neurons that emit microwave signals, so their output is a microwave signal, and that they emit at frequencies that are close to the resonant frequencies of the junctions here, you see that this neuron is going to talk only to this junction because only this one will respond in the corresponding band. This neuron is going to talk to this synapse, this neuron to this one, and this one to this one. By doing so, it means that the collected voltage, it means that there is no interference between the junction and the collected voltage is a weighted sum of the input microwave signals. And what's interesting here, you see that we have only one wire instead of having the four wires that are usually needed for this kind of connectivity. So I'm not going into details, but we have a small experimental demonstration with two magnetic tunnel junctions. We have demonstrated this multiply and accumulate operation here. And now if we want to go beyond to make a neural network, first we need to have several output neurons. So for this, it's very easy because you just have to make other synaptic chains, one synaptic chain per neuron. And they will receive the same input. Simply, they will have slightly different resonant frequency because they are going to emulate different synaptic weights. Okay, so again, here we have two wires instead of eight. So you see that frequency multiplexing allows to reduce the number of wires. What we have shown through simulations is that we can take into account the physical behavior of the devices. So here it's a simulation where there is no noise, but we can really model how these devices respond to microwave inputs, model their nonlinearity, their frequencies, so on and so forth. And we have used this to show through simulations that the fact that they are not really synaptic weights, you know, that they have this very specific response shape and they are a bit nonlinear, we can recognize handwritten digits with an accuracy that is as good as software. And this is done in this paper. And so now this opens the path, you see, to making neural networks. depends on these elements. And so we, I showed you that we have neurons that take DC inputs and apply a nonlinear function and emit the output in the form of a microwave. And we have synapses that can take these microwaves, weight them, make the multiply and accumulate operation, and transform it into a DC voltage that we can again feed to neurons and so on and so forth. So we can, in principle, build these large arrays of magnetic tunnel junctions to form deep networks that could solve either tasks where the inputs are, you know, DC currents or pulses, so coming from the digital world, or that could directly probe microwave signal from the outside world. So of course, this is very challenging. So there are different, many things to solve. And in particular, we are going to need some amplification stages between the synapses and the neurons. And for this, now we are working with RF CMOS designer. We would like to make a small chip, integrated chip to demonstrate this, this concept. And we think that we can scale up. So we have estimated that in a chain, we could go up to 500 synapses per neuron. And if we want to increase the size, we can put several chains one after the other to go to higher numbers. Okay, and so of course, this is a huge challenge. And so we are working on that now. Okay, so that's all for this part. I don't know if you have questions before I move to the second part, which is very distinct and concerns algorithms.
Sorry, maybe about the scalability, because you have to introduce all these elements to do the synapses. Do you think this is an architecture that can be scaled, or maybe it's not a problem because everything is so small? I don't know.
Yeah, so that's what I was trying to say. So I mean, for now it's theoretical, but we think that in each chain we can have up to 500 synapses. So it's 500 synapses per neuron, and you see how it's organized here. The advantage of this way of organizing the elements is that everything is, it's not a crossbar array, everything is straight and easy to interconnect layer after layer. So in principle, it's easy. Of course, then we are dealing with, you know, nano device with their variability, etc. And we also, so there is a challenge of doing this interconnection, and then there is a challenge of learning. And so, of course, today, doing backpropagation in this kind of networks is very challenging to do it in a low power way. And so this is what I'm going to discuss in the second part, that maybe there could be some other algorithms that are more adapted to learning with the dynamical systems.
And then maybe another curiosity, this is, is there anything in the physical hardware that forbids you to use it as undirected?
So if we have to amplify, yes, because most amplifiers are unidirectional. So, but the junctions themselves are bidirectional. So in principle, yeah, we could. This is something we are trying to figure out.
Okay. Thanks.
Hi, Julia, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you if there are more proposals of neural networks in physical systems apart from the electronic and spintronic ones for constructing the synapses and the neurons, I mean.
Yes. So there is a lot of work, as you know, in optics and photonics. Also, I mean, superconductive Josephson junctions, for example, are very interesting. People are working on organic systems also. It's a very rich and active field. I mean, there are also very beautiful work in synthetic biology, I saw. So it's very broad. And which solution will be the best is very far from being clear. Of course, one advantage of photonics and electronics is the compatibility. Is the compatibility with CMOS, basically.
Okay, thank you.
I can have another question. It's related to how you input the information. Because I can think of an image and you convert each of the pixels to a frequency. Mm. And if you would have, for example, a time series, it would enter directly or?
Yeah, so it's a very good point. So here what I'm showing for a static network, mm-hmm. If we want to process time series, we have to combine a little bit, you know, what we did with reservoir computing with this kind of architecture. So this is not, uh-huh. I have not shown here. For me, we don't really know how to do it, but it's something we want to study in the future. So, but it would mean that we need, like, for example, we would not go directly to the synapse. We would probably have a layer of neurons that would handle the time series input and then be transformed before going to this. Well, we would need to figure it out.
Okay. And just another question, because I think I got lost at some point. But okay. What is introducing the memory here?
Okay. Yes, very good point. So the memory is a resonant frequency. Uh-huh. So, I mean, the resonant frequency of these junctions are, where is it? Here. It's really due is the fact that when you have a magnetic dot, the boundaries of the dot is like a potential well for the magnetization. So it has this resonant frequency that is intrinsic. And if you are able to change this potential well, you can, in a non-volatile way, you can change the resonant frequency in a non-volatile ways. And so it has been shown recently that by applying some voltage, you can, using some interfacial effects, you can really modify the frequency of a junction like that in a non-volatile way. So so it's feasible.
Okay. Thank you.
And because you see that when you change the resonance frequency, you change the weight actually, so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, then I will move to the second part of my talk, which is on an algorithm. But I have very little time. Okay. Well, you let me know if I talk too much. Or so I will talk about equilibrium propagation. So the motivation for this is that the state-of-the-art algorithm for neural network, backpropagation of error, is really not hardware friendly. So we have seen how difficult it is to make a physical neural network. So you need first to have all these devices, your synapses, your neurons, and you need to interconnect them together in a way that is going to provide all these operations of neural network, and that in the end you have something that is not, that is accurate. Okay, so it's already, and to have all these very dense interconnections, this is already very difficult. Okay, but if you do that, you only have what is called inference, but you don't have the learning part. This is only the forward pass. And to do the backpropagation of error, you need a backward pass. The idea is that you are going to do supervised learning. So you are going to present images, for example, images where you know the result that you expect, and you are going to see what is the response of your network, and you are going to compute an error. So it's a cost function. And the idea is that if you want the network to learn after this forward pass, you need to be able to modify each synaptic weight in the network by an amount that depends on its contribution to the error at the output. And so in order to do that, it's easy for the first synapses, but for the ones that are buried, you need to use a chain rule of derivation. And this is called the backpropagation of errors. And you see that it's very mathematical thing. And so it means that if you want to do this with a circuit, first you need a circuit to perform the gradient computation, all these mathematical operations. And then you need to store all these gradients somewhere. And there is one gradient per synapse. So you need a big memory close to your physical neural network. And then you are not done, because once you have computed and stored all the gradients, well, you need to apply them, because you want to change, to modify all your synapses to make the network closer to your solution. So you want to do that. And so you probably don't want to do it sequentially, because if you have hundreds of millions of synapses, you'd rather do it in parallel. So you are going to need a huge programming circuit to apply the voltages across your synapses to have these changes. And you are going to have to do so after each forward pass, hundreds of, well, I mean, millions of times before the network converge and learn. And so this is really a challenge in hardware to do all this in a low power way. I mean, doing the neural network is going to gain a lot of energy, but if you lose everything by doing these big circuits, you have a problem. So today there are many groups who are working in this area, trying to design circuits to do that, but it's very complicated. This is why the IBM chip that I showed in the beginning is not doing the backpropagation of error. Yeah, so it's a technical challenge. And so this is why, in fact, most neuromorphic chips, they don't use the backprop, even if this is the best algorithm. They use what is called local learning rules, such as spike timing dependent plasticity. So what is a local learning rule? Well, this is inspired from the brain. So in the brain, you don't have a kind of a circuit. I mean, you only have your synapses and neurons, right? And what's happening is that you don't have additional circuits. The synapses evolve through the spikes of the neurons that they connect directly, of the two neurons. So for example, there is this famous learning rule that is called spike timing dependent plasticity. It explains how a synapse is going to change depending on the timing of the spikes of the two neurons that the synapse connect. And it shows that it depends which spike comes first, etc. And this has been observed in biology. This is a biological measurement. And this is local because the synapse evolves due to the local quantities that are the neural spikes here. And of course, this is much easier to do in hardware, right? Because you would have only your circuit that you build. And if your neurons, for example, they can emit voltage spikes, the memory stores that connect the neuron is going to have across it a voltage that is the difference between the post-neuron and the pre-neuron voltages, okay? And in fact, if you choose well these kind of spikes of your neurons, these kind of voltage shapes that they are going to emit, it has been shown that with memory stores, you can reproduce this spike timing dependent plasticity that we have seen. So you see the curves are very similar from biology, okay? So this is very nice because you have a rule for modifying your synaptic weights that does not need additional circuit and memories. The synapse evolves directly due to the neuron signals. So it's very low energy, easier to make. The difficulty is the low accuracy of this algorithm because synapses are changed only due to this local information. This kind of learning rule is not going to minimize the error at the output. And minimizing an error at the output through the gradients in the network is what ensures a very good accuracy. This is why in the IBM chip, they had only maybe 92% recognition rate. So how can we do? Well, in my group, we are studying an algorithm that is called equilibrium propagation that I think really offers solution to on-chip learning with low energy and high accuracy. So the idea of equilibrium propagation is to go back to physics, basically, and to say, okay, let's make a neural network But this neural network is going not to going to be static as in software, it's going to be differ with two things. First, it's going to be dynamical. So it means that the neurons are going to be dynamical objects that evolve in time. So for example, we can call SI the neuron state, and they are going to evolve with time, and they are going to minimize an energy function. Okay, so they are going to evolve in this way. And as the other big difference, that the synapses are going to be bidirectional, so that the signals can propagate in the two directions. And the input neurons are going to be clamped. So these ones are fixed. And so because this system derives from an energy, when you reach an equilibrium, you minimize the energy function, okay? And so equilibrium propagation is going to take advantage of this property. So how can we learn through equilibrium propagation? The idea is to use two phases. First, so you have your dynamical neural network and you present a new input, for example, a new image. When you present a new input to your network, because it's a dynamical neural network, it was at some equilibrium point, and now it's going to be perturbed. So all neurons are going to move, and because everything is connected and synapses are bidirectional, so the system, the whole system is going to change, and at some point, it's going to reach an equilibrium. So you do that, wait for equilibrium, then you measure all the states of the neurons. This is called the free phase. Then you look at the neuron states here, because this is your output response, and you see your error, okay? And if you have an error, what you want to do is to bring your system closer to the desired output. And so Benjamin Cellier and Joshua Benjo have proposed the algorithm, the following method. The idea is to apply some spring-like force to the output neurons. In fact, to take them and to bring them, to nudge them towards the desired output, so that the error is reduced. So when you do that, your inputs here are still clamped, but you are going to modify the dynamics of the system at the output. Because everything, again, is dynamical and bidirectional, these perturbations here are going to propagate through the network. And then you wait for equilibrium, and you measure the different neural state. I think there's a question, maybe.
Yes, please. You talk here about a dynamic network in the sense that the state of the nodes of the neurons is changing, but yes, you keep the weight of the links fixed. Is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, 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 totally, yeah.
But you could also change
dynamically. Yes, you could, yes, yes. But in the, I'm coming to this, in the algorithm proposed by Benjo and Cellier, they are fixed for now, and then you change them.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, so you nudge the network, and then again you wait for the equilibrium and you measure the neuron state. And what is very interesting is that if you make the mass here, you by subtracting these two equations, I forgot to say something very important. By doing so, by applying the spring-like force at the output, it's equivalent to modifying the energy function of the network by adding to the energy of the network the cost function, the error, you know, at the output. And so when you do the math, you find that if you do that, the state of each neuron is going to be modified by the gradient with respect to the cost function. So it means that the nudging the output is equivalent to propagating gradients through the network, but these are gradients on the neurons, okay? What we want to calculate are gradients on the synapse. And so if you push the mass and suppose some energy function, you can find that the gradient that you need to apply to each synapse weight is equal to this quantity. So what this means is that you do free phase, where synapses are fixed. You do a nudging phase, neurons evolve, synapses are fixed. You measure here, you measure the states in this phase and you measure after this phase, okay? So you know the neuron states. Rho is the activation function of the neurons. And it means that if you apply then this change to the synaptic weights, what you are going to do is that you are going to stabilize this new equilibrium step that was closer to the desired state of your network. So what is very interesting is that what you can see is that a synaptic weight is modified, doesn't need to be calculated first. You just measure the states and do a subtraction. And it is local. It only depends on the states of neuron I and J. Okay, so what it means is that the dynamics of the neural network does the backpropagation of the gradients, and then you only need to apply them. And so this is very interesting for neuromorphic chips. So what we have shown recently, without going into detail, is that this simple local learning rule has a mathematical equivalence with backpropagation through time. So it really computes the gradient of the system. So in principle, it can reach state-of-the-art accuracy. Now, a difficulty to prove this is that we need, this is a dynamical neural network. These are complex coupled differential equations to solve. So simulating this on a computer takes a lot of resources and time. Nevertheless, we have been able to show recently that this algorithm can solve a task, image recognition task, that is called CIFAR-10, that is more challenging than MNIST, but is not yet the standard benchmark today that is called the ImageNet, and that is very difficult to solve, mainly because of the time. We don't have the resources to do it. Of course, this is due to the fact that we simulate on GPUs. If we were to be able to do a hardware, it could be very fast. And also we have shown recently that even though this looks like a very analog dynamical procedure, in fact, this algorithm can train binary neural network where we have two-state synapses and two-state neurons. So this is very good because when you have only binary synapses and binary neurons, you are much more resilient to variability of your device. So these are really, you know, this is not directly related to devices. These are more abstract models to test the interest of this algorithm for hardware. So what I have shown for now is that basically equilibrium propagation replaces a gradient computation by gradient measurement. We need to measure the neural state and we don't have the backpropagation open or happens directly. Still, we need to store these gradients and program the circuits. So we thought, can we do better than that? And the answer is yes. So our idea was to transform this equilibrium into a spiking version. So actually what we have shown first is that we don't need to wait for the end of the nudging phase to update the weights. We can change the weights as we nudge, as we apply the spring-like force on the output neurons. So I'm not going into details, but if we modify the synapses with this learning rule here, while we nudge the output neurons, then the network is going to learn as we want to have the good gradients, okay? And so we thought, well, then this is very nice because here we have a very simple learning rule that is local. So why don't we construct a circuit that is going to directly, you know, produce this learning rule? And we thought, well, it would be very nice to do it with a spiking neural network because when you use a spiking neural network, these activation functions, actually, they can be the frequency of the spikes. They are the synaptic rates directly. So when you look at the learning rule, you see that if rho is the frequency of your spiking neuron, rho dot is the derivative of the rate. You see that there are two terms that are symmetrical. So it means that if you look at this, what it means is that if you have a synapse between two spiking neurons, if you want to apply this learning rule, it means that all you have to do is that each time neuron I spike, you have to apply this, you have to apply a synaptic change proportional to the derivative of the rate of neuron J to your synaptic weight, okay? And reciprocally. And so when you have a spiking neural network, actually what we did is that it's easy to propose some electronic systems that can compute this quantity. So we have done it here. And so this small circuit here can implement this learning rule. And so what we did is that we have made some simulation of this circuit, abstract simulation, but to show the validity of our concept. And we have shown that by using this technique, so spiking version of equilibrium propagation, we could build hardware compatible spiking neural network that can be trained on chip in principle and achieve very high accuracy compared to, hardware adapted algorithm like the STDP. We really gain a lot in accuracy. So what it means is that if we do that, instead of doing backprop in hardware with all these circuits, we don't need all these big building blocks. We could perform gradient descent directly just with our inference circuit, basically, just with our neurons and synapses. So it could really reduce considerably the power efficiency of learning on chip. And what we want to do is to demonstrate that it's possible to do it, of course, with nano devices. And so we are working towards this goal. So it's very challenging, but we think that this new kind of algorithms that exploit more physics on the, on the hardware, that exploits, in fact, the dynamical feature of your hardware, is much more adapted than artificial methods like backprop, that this kind of methods are the most adapted to gain a lot of energy, a lot of electrical consumption. Okay, so that's the end of my talk. So I have shown two things. I have discussed how we can leverage physics in terms of nano devices or spintronics for interconnections, in terms of dynamics and spikes in neural network for learning. So for now, these two are completely unrelated, but we hope, of course, to be able to apply this algorithm to spintronic system as well and maybe help learning in the dense network that I showed at the beginning. Thank you very much for listening.
Thanks a lot, Julie, for the nice presentation. I think there will be some questions from the audience. We already had a few in the after the first part. Maybe now people have questions about the second. If that's not the case, maybe I can start. I don't know if you tried different approaches of training in intrinsic training in hardware besides the EPROB. Are you aware of any other possibilities in that?
That you could you mean if we explore other algorithms for hardware? There are many possibilities. So it's very, and as you know, the field is moving so fast. So,
yes.
So this is something that we want to explore, but I think EPROB is a good start because what I'm really interested in is to exploit the dynamics of for learning and computing. And so we are trying to focus on algorithms that do that. I think EPROB is a good starting point. Of course, there are other possibilities. One nice thing of EPROB is that the signals can be, the backpropagation is done through these bidirectional synapses, which avoids to have other circuits to do the backward pass, you know? So I think it's very adapted to hardware. But other algorithms can be very interesting.
Yeah, it's good to have a start, yes. Indeed.
Yes.
Hi, maybe a curiosity.
No?
Hi. I don't know if there is any chance to take the devices you have been shown into the quantum regime to operate. Are devices that display coherences or any quantum effects, or I assume that I'm asking because
it is actually so there are some theoretical proposals to use ferromagnetic spintronic devices as quantum systems. And for example, you can have some emulations of Josephson junctions with spintronic systems, and if you cool them, you are going to have a quantum oscillator, basically. Now there are some challenges due to the fact that magnetic systems tend to damp, so we need materials that are very low damping to maintain the coherence. But in principle, it's feasible, and it's something we want to study, but I don't think we can succeed. Like, it will take a few years to succeed.
Okay, thanks.
I also have a question regarding the part of interconnections. So basically, you focused on the possibility to connect the neuron in one layer to as many neurons as possible from the previous one, right? And then with a different weight in each. That's the limit you say is 500 for the moment, right? And when you try to solve these tasks, maybe in software, is 500, this connectivity 500 enough? Is it a good number in general?
Yeah, so it depends. So, I mean, first, what I want to say is that we can do more than 500 by simply adding the results from different chains. So we can do more in principle. And it really depends what you want to do. So when you do a fully connected layer, often you need a huge amount of synapses, like thousands. So, but I think we could reach them by combining different chains together. And when you do some, here I didn't show, but this frequency multiplexing scheme allows to do convolutional layers. And in that case, of course, we need much less synapse per neuron. But the advantage of this frequency multiplexing, you see that by choosing carefully the frequencies of the resonators versus the frequency of neurons, we can connect a bit as we want. And so we are writing the paper now, but this allows to make very dense convolutional layers, we think, that would work fully in parallel. So there is some flexibility here in the choice of the connections that you cannot achieve when you just have wires. So this is nice.
Yeah, it's a good idea to use waves for that. Yes. Are there any other questions? Okay, maybe it doesn't seem to be the case. So thanks a lot, Julie, for the presentation.
Well, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.
See you. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.